And I know, a few things. I had the impression toward the end that though I often say, really, any question, any challenge, any, I like what you're saying, but I don't know how that can be true and this can be true, or any personal anecdote of your own, all of this is welcome. I prefer a lot of back and forth over me talking. I become afraid if I'm talking a lot more than other people are talking, that it's a monologue rather than a dialogue. And a monologue feels like propaganda to me. And I like to say propaganda ends when dialogue begins. Propaganda can't afford dialogue. Yeah. So when the time comes, please, lots of back and forth. And I mentioned I welcome emails, and I got one. And it was from Linda, who said she didn't mind me noting that she emailed me. And she was recalling the cracker and grape juice story in the Kroger parking lot and said, it sounds like, and this is the way it usually goes, there's religion going on there, there's ideology going on, and you changed. And she said, was there an event that changed? And I had a couple of responses to that. One way I changed, one, I think this is how we always change, is I was somehow able to, and we noted this, I had my lonely reading of the Bible, and I had Steve Martin and Star Trek and all of these other things, and somehow, blessedly, in my home, I was not taught to think that my devotional time, my Sunday school time, my catechesis time, was to be kept in a container away from everything else. As if a television show was going to be a challenge to my reading of the Bible. Somehow I was taught, or I came to believe, that it's all mutual enrichment, that I don't need to protect Steve Martin from my religion, and I don't need to protect religion from Steve Martin. So there at a very early age, 17, I was trying to create a situation for myself that I didn't have to, I didn't have to deny my own critical thinking ability in order to be faithful to this tradition that demanded, as I understood it at that point in time, that I have the crackers and grape juice within a 24-hour span, or I was going to be in trouble. Another response to that, too, is, and I hesitate to put it, I'm going to put it very, very carefully. I'm going to speak very, very carefully. Other people helped me with my religion, my ideology, my strange ideas about the world. And so when Linda asked about that, I immediately recalled that in the late 80s, I had, so I'm going to say this very, very carefully, I had what proved to be an inappropriate attachment to the ideas of Rush Limbaugh. Hooray for Rush Limbaugh, still. But as a teenager, I was letting Rush Limbaugh have too much of my thinking. Is that a helpfully value-neutral way of speaking of Rush Limbaugh? Yeah. So I was letting him do my thinking for me a little too much when I was a teenager. So everything that I beheld, every conflict that I experienced when it came to ideas, I had fantastic mother and father who I could have drawn from. But for some reason, Rush Limbaugh was more compelling to me when I was a teenager. And I did not hesitate to quote Rush Limbaugh and not always attribute the quote to him. I guess I'll put it this way. I didn't hesitate to quote Rush Limbaugh and not realize that I was quoting Rush Limbaugh. Not realizing that I was simply saying what I had heard him say loudly and humorously and effectively to people who were having conversations to him, with him, on call-in radio kind of thing. So, I was there as a teenager, and there were people who met me who were sometimes surprised, sometimes shut down by my inner Rush Limbaugh. But they didn't judge me for that, and they knew that there was more to me than me repeating what Rush Limbaugh had said on the way to school. And those people, guess you could call them a great cloud of witnesses as well, would credit me sometimes with more intelligence than I had, and who would note that I was reading a good novel, or that I was into Bob Dylan, or something like that. And they would take what they could affirm in my life, and they would ramp it up. And, oh goodness, we even have a line from Paul. He says that knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. So I had my knowledge, or what I took to be my knowledge, and I would try and duke it out with people. And often, if that was going badly for me and I didn't even realize it, people would love me anyway. And I was converted to better ways of being in the world. And let me emphasize again, I would still have a degree of fondness for Rush Limbaugh, but he's not enough of a sacred tradition for me or anyone. We need more than one voice. Does this make sense? I'll note, too, I share the work of Wendell Berry with some of my incarcerated students. I share Shakespeare with my incarcerated students. And one time, especially with Wendell Berry, there was this one student, a Muslim student, who had been in prison for 27 years. And I introduced him to Wendell Berry, and he loved Wendell Berry. And he said, Wendell Berry really got me. He really schooled me. And he said, Wendell Berry is now in my pantheon of elders. Right there next to Tupac Shakur. Wendell Berry and Tupac Shakur. And Tupac Shakur, I don't know if we know this name, but when it comes to hip-hop music, rap music, Tupac Shakur is kind of the Elvis of reality. A big deal, Tupac Shakur. But so we read Wendell Berry together, and his pantheon of elders expanded. And that particular student has introduced me to all kinds of folks that that I need, that help me. Skipping around a tiny bit, but pantheon of elders is one way of naming a concept that we might get to today that I call an attention collection. As in, we all have an attention collection. We all have things that people have said, movies we've seen, songs that we love, and they're there for a reason. They spoke to us once upon a time, for better or worse, for a reason. And I don't want to mix these two concepts too much, but they are very close. They're practically the same thing. In our pantheon of elders, those are the voices of people who have gotten through to us, or wounded us, or lifted us up. And I bet we all have in our minds 50 to 100, maybe, I mean, just folks whose voices come back to us, sometimes unbidden, when we're trying to think things through. And if there's one voice that tries to shut down all of the other voices in our pantheon of elders, if there's one voice that won't let other people finish their sentences, then maybe we need to hand the microphone to somebody else in our pantheon of elders every once in a while. So, getting back to this question, I had developing around me folks that I respected. I'll say, for instance, that this one guy, a Presbyterian minister I met while in college, drank wine in front of me one time. And that was traumatizing for me at that point in time, because I grew up in a situation where there was a little bottle of Jack Daniels that my dad had saved when he was on an airplane one time as a souvenir. And he had it, it was just sitting there, the seal was on it. And I would look at that bottle of Jack Daniels and I would think, if I ever want to just not have to worry about it anymore and know that I'm going to hell, I can just take a sip of whiskey from that little bottle. That'll do it. I had this thing with the crackers and grape juice, but then I had this little bottle of whiskey that was there. It was almost comforting. If I ever want to let go of the anguish of what's going to happen to me, I can know for sure if I just take a sip of this. So when the Presbyterian minister, when I was a teenager, when I saw him drink wine, and I'd heard him talk about Bonhoeffer and quote the Bible and all that kind of thing, I knew he struck me as legit. But he drank wine. And so now I have a crisis, and I have to figure out, am I going to think that he is in that number of acceptable people, kosher people, the right kind of people? Or am I going to throw him under the bus as a bad person because he drinks wine socially? And I made it through. So we have all of that. I made it. I was willing to think that it's possible that he's a Christian, even though he drinks wine. And we have these. I mean, we probably have. Well, I do know that one person who voted for that person I would never vote for. And I think that person's a Christian. I think so. Or I think that person's a good person, a righteous person, you know, whatever that might be. So many, many little steps along the way. We're still going to get to this poem, but your hand went up. So I'm going to come over to you, and I'm going to see what you have to say. Oh, it's totally fine. So we can, I've got material, but it can be a Donahue situation the whole time if it needs to be.
Yeah.
If it needs to be, yes.
Didn't Jesus drink wine?
Oh, absolutely, yes. But here's the horror of it.
Where does the prohibition come from then?
Okay,
in your church?
Yes, I bet somebody can answer. Somebody knows that I was taught that when Jesus turned water into wine, that it was wine that somehow magically and possibly did not have any alcohol in it. So that was there. I laugh. I think it is good to laugh at that idea, because I think that is a misreading of Scripture. But as is often the case, you've got the sacred Scripture, you have your cultural norms, and when the Scripture does not reaffirm the cultural norms, we change the meaning of Scripture. And we have that going on now, big time. Of course, even swearing on a Bible. It's a funny thing to swear on a Bible. Anybody know why it's especially funny to swear on a Bible? Because Jesus specifically forbids swearing. So it's odd. It'll be interesting. Future generations, why did they think that was okay? Is it possible that they swore on it, but they never actually read it? Yes, that is possible. We know this. We know this. Okay, so I'm going to go back. Oh, my goodness, there's another hand. Okay, so we're going to keep going with this.
I don't need the microphone. I just
want to know what your email is. Oh, my email is david.dark@belmont.edu. david.dark@belmont.edu. And if you go online, you can find me. If you Google David Dark, it'll take you to daviddark.org, and it'll put you somewhere where you can email me. But yeah, david.dark@belmont.edu. Another great thing from Linda's email, she said, I think to be Christian, you have to be open to new things. And I think that's true. And she even used the language of evolution. I always want to be evolving. So to be truly Buddhist, truly Jewish, truly Muslim, truly a philosopher, and a philosopher is just someone who loves wisdom, who seeks wisdom, to be truly any of these things, I think all too often, that's one reason I insist on the word tradition when somebody says religion, because to exist within a tradition is to be devoted to a form of thoughtfulness. Unfortunately, the word religion does not mean thoughtfulness necessarily in our day. But to be devoted to thoughtfulness is to be devoted to, Paul's language again, to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Rather than being conformed to death-dealing or dysfunctional cultural patterns, you're committed to being transformed to better cultural patterns. Kind of thing. Your hand was up. Do you have a word?
Did you grow up in a world of absolutes?
A world of absolutes. Yes, somehow I come from a long line of teachers, both sides. I don't want, though my mother, who is still with us, was also devoted to this crackers and grape juice thing. I feel bad about putting it that way. I don't mean to imply, it's silly. I mean, no, not at all. I have my own panics. When panic attack, that's saying too much. I want my kids to take seriously communion, Eucharist, ritual, all of this. So kind of yes to the absolutes. I mean, I absolutely could not say shut up aloud in the house. We absolutely were going to take in that member of our congregation who we discovered was living in a storage unit. Right, so we had a homeless man who lived in my bedroom with me for a while. So many an absolute in terms of what does neighborliness look like, what does being part of this process called Christianity involve, but to even put it that way is to perhaps challenge the absolutizing of experience. I know it was kind of late in the game that I met someone who said, if you don't know when you accepted Jesus into your heart, you probably never did. What day did that? So that was kind of an absolutizing that was new to me as a teenager, and I guess I kind of fell for it for a while. But I kept going deeper into the tradition, which will always challenge, to a degree, our sense of what's absolute. Maybe another way of putting it, and I apologize again if it's estranging to anyone for me to keep going back to biblical references, but when I read Paul saying we see through a glass darkly or a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face, I hear absolute. We will see what's true absolutely one day is a hope held by more than one adherent to a sacred tradition. But for now, no one has a God's eye view. No one owns the copyright on truth. For now, we're all learners of truth rather than copyright owners of absolute truth and here I come with truth kind of thing. I think that's ultimately an idolatrous posture because it's not the posture of a learner or a fellow pilgrim or a disciple. It's the posture of someone who believes that they're infallible. And even the doctrine of infallibility when it comes to the Pope, both for this Pope and this Pope's predecessors, that very idea, the first prayer of the Pope is the prayer of Peter, which is, depart from me, I'm a sinful man. So there's a doctrine, oh goodness, I just have to throw this in. Martin Luther, the figure most associated with the Reformation, famously said, I started out wanting to question one particular pope. But now, there's a pope on every dunghill in Germany. Meaning, I wanted to challenge a particular reading of scripture, but this movement that started led to millions of people thinking they don't need anybody to understand what the Bible's saying but themselves. So something communal is lost in a particular form of Protestantism, we might say. I say that as a Protestant. Does that speak to these questions of...
Do you think as an adult now you were wounded by that whole attitude of, I've got the answer?
Yes.
You don't have it, I'll pray for it.
Okay, well, I want to be careful. I mean, my folks, my mother, a lifetime public school teacher, Doris Sharp, who became Doris Dark. She went to Southwestern, which is now Rhodes, and she's at Woodmont Christian right now, very likely. Or she's often either at Woodmont Christian or at the home where I grew up in Creef Hall. Amazing woman, my Yoda in so many ways. And my dad was pretty great, too. I think of him as a cross between Atticus Finch and Columbo in a way. So they were great. I would say that I learned from them. Went to Central Church of Christ, as I've mentioned. But when the sermon was over, we would go out to Shoney's near where the stadium is now. I think that Shoney's is still there. And we would talk about the sermon. And we all liked the preachers that were there. But there was this attitude of, we heard it, now we talk about it. And we would disagree with what was said. And I had a feeling that even as a child, that the Bible was mysterious, and anyone who claims to have it on their side at all times is trying to sell you something, in a way. So there was a skepticism that I was raised on. But I would say that I don't want to dramatize it too much to use the language of wound, even though I know that's very familiar in many of our upbringings. I think I had enough people around me to protect me from falling for any particular cult at one time. And by cult, I mean cult in a value-neutral sense. Cult is culture. Different things are getting cultivated all the time. In the English language, when something is getting cultivated within a group of people in such a way that everyone else is hopelessly wrong, and only your association with this cult will save you. I mean, that is generally what we call a cult. I think I entered into conversations with more than one, but there were too many people I knew who I thought wise who weren't part of those particular communities for me to drink the Kool-Aid completely. And yet, part of the thesis of my book is that we're all drinking the Kool-Aid in one way or another all of the time. So a young man's, what I projected into my reading of the Bible and what I was being told in Sunday school, I would kind of credit that a little more than putting it on particular people if I can. And we have another.
I can speak
mine. Okay.
They
want you to be recorded on that.
Oh, okay.
So there we go.
I would like to ask you the question, as you teach at Belmont, as you go and do your prison ministry.
Yes.
What do you find to be the edge? In other words, as you're informing but not conforming, mm-hmm. What is the edge where we learn about Buddhism, we learn about Muslims, we learn about Judaism, we learn about that, we learn about culture and how it changes in our lifetime in this room. Where do you go? Where's that fine line where you can push them into another religion as opposed to making them strong about the convictions that they have toward Jesus, our Savior?
Gotcha. I would not think it my job if somebody said, oh, I hear you're going to Riverbend tonight. I'm really glad that you're involved in a prison ministry. I would, depending on who I was talking to, I might say, thank you. Or I might say, I don't think of it as a ministry. And with that, I'll explain. Actually, it's the very same inmate who said that Wendell Berry was now in his pantheon of elders. Once when I was in there, and I've been at it for about 6 or 7 years, I've been to Riverbend, I've been to Charles Bass, I've been to Turney Center just past Bucksnort. I've mostly taught in the women's prison, TPW, and Riverbend as well. But once when I was giving my spiel, like, here I am, I'm David Dark, glad to be among you, we're going to do some reading, we're going to talk about our writing, this particular student said, I have a question, says, I feel a lot of respect for you, the work that you do. We had just met, and this guy has been in jail for 27 years. He said, here's a question. Are you a Matthew 25 Christian? And by that, to be specific, Matthew 25 is the sheep and the goats thing, where the story Jesus tells is the Son of Man is saying to some, come on in to my kingdom. Why? Because when I was clothed, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was sick, you looked after me. When I was in prison, you visited me. And it really interestingly with those folks, the sheep, they don't know anything about the Son of Man. They just looked after people. They're like, when did we do that? Whenever you did it unto the least of these. Okay, so I bet most of us have heard this. And then you've got the goats who seem to have believed all the right things, but never looked after the least of these. And it's a depart from me, I never knew you. So this guy, this Muslim actually, I mean, it was a great question. Are you a Matthew 25 Christian? Meaning, do you view us as your ministry? Are you holding eye contact with me right now because this is your way to Jesus? Do you think of me as someone who you have a mission to? And behind that, he put the question very gently, but was, of course, this is a very condescending situation. If your appearance here among us is a kind of, I'm here for charity. I'm here to enlighten you. So, the question was there, are you a Matthew 25 Christian? To which I said, that is a real gift of a question. I'm going to have to think about it for a moment before I answer it. And so then we talked about other things, and then finally I said, okay, I think I got it. I think I have a good response. I view each of you, and I'm addressing, you know, probably 10 or 11 folks, most of whom are going to die in prison. I said, I view each of you as bearers of wisdom, experience, stories. In fact, I view each of you as a kind of living library of intuition and insight and all manner of information that I need. I'm here to help you access that, to work on your writing, to work on your reading, all of this, but I don't come in as, hello, I'm your mentor. I'm David Dark. I said, instead, I view this as a community of mentors. Thank you for letting me be among you. My mentors, this community of mentors. And he liked that answer. And maybe I'll come up with a better one. But he was enough, he religious enough. He is, was religious, but he did not view one sacred tradition as true to the exclusion of other traditions. Okay, it doesn't mean it's all the same. Okay, so please don't misunderstand me. It doesn't mean all sacred traditions are saying the same thing. I'm not saying that. But he did view, he had Christians who help him in his walk, and he has Muslims, he has Buddhists, and he had kind of a different way. But I'm still thinking about this, the edge of it. I want to bring people whatever is going to be helpful. And there are those who are so wounded by what passed for Christianity in their upbringing, that they may never be able to look favorably upon that tradition again. I hope they can, but it goes that way sometimes. So I think I just want to be helpful. I want to be on the side of being transformed by the renewing of one's mind, waking up. Buddha, as you may know, means the enlightened one, the awakened one. So consciousness, salvation, righteousness, awakening, all of those, I mean, those are all, that's kind of an interfaith vocabulary that I just offered. And I think in my work, I'm looking to be as helpful as I can. And when I, this could be a little to the side of what I'm talking about, but if I'm, one time I was helping a fella with a paper and he had, what I'll do is I'll take him home and I'll write notes and things. And in one instance, I couldn't find a lot that I could affirm in this particular paper. There were a few words that I thought, good word choice. I like that sentence. But it was like three pages with no paragraph break. So I put a little asterisk where I thought a new paragraph could start. And I said, when you do this again, you're going to want to indent wherever I put an asterisk. He said, okay. And then we kept going. And then I said, is this making sense? And he said, yeah. And I said, okay, I'm going to move on, but is there anything that I said that wasn't clear to you? And he took a deep breath and he said, what is indent again? And I thought, thank you, Lord, that I asked again. Thank you, Lord, that I get to be the person who is here to tell this 30-something-year-old man what indention means. And I won't curse, but daggummit, you people, wherever we want to put those people, who let him go through years of alleged education and never doubled back. But, I mean, go into any, my wife is an assistant librarian at J.T. Moore, go into any public school and ask yourself, what do I need to do to get smaller classroom sizes? What do I need to do to get more resources? What do I need to do? I don't mean to should on anyone right now, but he went through this system, which is our system, which we're paying for, and somehow he made it this far, and no one had asked twice enough. Did he want to know what an indention, what a paragraph? You bet. I have no doubt that he hungered and thirsted for all of that. But so anyway, here I am. I get to do that. I want to do that. That's my edge. I want to help people figure out what's going on inside them and become less estranged from the inner drama of their own lives. That's good religion, in my view. Neighborliness, all that kind of stuff. And I'm so grateful that I get paid to do that kind of thing. The saddest I've ever been is when I thought that I might not have that as a paying gig again. I'm doing all this little memoir stuff now, but I taught at Christ Pres Academy. I left Christ Pres to go to Vanderbilt. I got a PhD at Vanderbilt, and there were lots of adjunct jobs, which you don't get paid much as an adjunct. And the full-time teaching gig, I wasn't sure that it was ever going to come again, but it did. It came, Belmont came through. I mention that to say the saddest I've ever been is when I felt really strongly that I'm a good teacher, but I wasn't sure that I was going to be able to earn a living wage teaching again. Sorry for going off on that tangent. Anybody got a question before we move on? Yes.
So when did you start realizing that this Rush guy... When did you start realizing that this
Brother
Rush
let's call him Brother Rush.
Was
Can we call
not
him Brother Rush?
The person that you should be listening to? I don't want to talk about him because some people like
he
him.
He is
and I want
something
to respect
of a,
whoever likes
something
him in the
of a
room.
Conversation stopper of a personality but, for some.
But I have felt very offended by his comments
okay.
myself.
Gotcha.
But so, I mean, seeing you, I know that when we're young, oh, we think we know it all.
Yeah.
And we're going to change the world. And we're going to teach
we
these
think
older
that we
people.
Alone can fix it
yes,
when we're young.
Yes, we're going to teach them
yeah.
All these things we've discovered
yeah.
and how wrong we are.
Mm-hmm.
So my question to you is, when did you start realizing that this one man was controlling your mind?
Okay. Thank you. And I'm going to respond, but I'm going to note, I'm going to work the word religion into it a little bit. If I was to say, I check this particular website every day, I live on the internet, I listen to this one person's, I play video games all day, I listen to this one person every day to figure out what's what. And then I said, but that has nothing to do with my religion. I would want to say, I mean, and I think this came up a couple courses back, your religion is your witness. Is the shape your loves and hates take. It's what you're devoted to. I don't think that's controversial at all, is that religion names the form of your devotion, whatever that might be. And the Bible is the one I'm most familiar with, but every sacred tradition overcomes, challenges those divisions whereby we want to say, no, that's just entertainment. This over here is business. This over here is my religion. This over here. So I'm going to keep trying to challenge those lines because I think those lines do great damage. You can issue this word of love your neighbor. Just three words, love your neighbor. And someone can say, too, love your neighbor. let's keep politics out of it. Like, what's more political than the question of who is my neighbor? And this, of course, is the question put to Jesus over and over again. To return to the question, I was enlivened, amped up. I didn't drink coffee at the time, but my coffee as a young man was the ministry of Rush Limbaugh. An espresso shot of offendedness that could get me through the day. I wake up kind of calm, but I got to get... And it did that for me in the late 80s. So, but how did I move? How did I move? Well, I guess I want to say that I have deep love and even respect. Yes, love and respect. And I am often out loved and out. It is often the case that the most neighborly people in my life are still allowing. Yeah. Okay, I'll put it this way. Many of the most neighborly people in my life still have much of their thinking dictated. They are under the influence of Rush Limbaugh, if we could put it that way. When did that change for me? I guess just when he became not enough. Oh, and it changed for me when he had a television program as well. I don't know if we're going to remember this, but he was on television for a good long time. And I was able to receive his counsel in my life easily when I'm just driving in a Chevette to Murfreesboro, listening to him. But then when I saw him on television, and I had to accommodate the look on his face. Oh, what is that? I mean, this probably we could tie this to the Kennedy-Nixon debates and that kind of thing. There was something way not so telegenic. And when he would say the things that felt empowering before, and I was beholding him saying those things, that was a harder pill to swallow for me. But also, I got surrounded by people, and hopefully we are all each surrounded by people who vote differently from the way we do. Hopefully we are each surrounded by people who were able to disagree with and it not be a disaster. It be a renewal of conversation rather than a shutting down of the conversation. So I had good conversation skills modeled for me, and just so much grace, the grace of neighbors. There is faithfulness to any tradition is relentlessly social. It takes a community to have a faith. If my faith is such that it doesn't leave any room for community, I'm in a death cult of one, I want to say. So again, this language of great cloud of witnesses, thoughtful people, communities of thoughtfulness became more attractive to me than my own I'm the one who knows what's what kind of thing. I became less difficult to be around. Does that speak to a degree?
I hope you met your wife after that.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. Oh, I mean, this is... I realized that I was not accustomed to defer. There's a moment. Oh, gosh, there's a moment in Genesis. This is the story of Judah and Tamar. I don't know if anybody knows it, but you're not going to see a VeggieTales version of this particular story. It's the Bible that people swear upon and say they want to see everywhere, so stay with me, but it is a very iffy, dysfunctional story, and I'm not even going to get into why Tamar was denied marriage to a third brother when the first two died. I will not, even if you said you would pay me, I would hesitate to read aloud a particular verse over why one of those brothers was killed by God in Genesis and was found wicked. But, so you've got Judah and his sons, and you've got Tamar, who would really like to have a place to live, would like to be part of the Jewish community, would like to be part of the deal, and her first two husbands, Judah's sons, die. She's promised to a third, but Judah kind of kicks her out. Judah kind of condemns her to refugee status. So Tamar places herself in Judah's path and pretends to be a prostitute. I mean, it's the Bible, so it's the Bible. Pretends to be a prostitute and tricks him into impregnating her. And so now, she's disguised as a prostitute. So now, pregnant, she has a chance to have access to life. But when Judah finds out that his daughter-in-law has, this is scripture, played the whore and has gotten pregnant, Judah says, well, bring her out here to be burned. Right? So this is a story in Genesis. Of course, the call to burn promiscuous people by particular people in the Bible isn't the Bible endorsing anything like that, any more than stoning an adulterous woman means, so that's what you do. Though both of these things are occurring in our world today. Anyway, Tamar shows up. She has Judah's staff, his signet ring. She has what she needs to not get killed by her father-in-law. And she says, the person whose child I bear, these are his. And so now Judah has to do a rethink, and he says, and it's amazing that this is spoken in this ancient civilization. It's part of what makes the Bible inspired. Judah says of Tamar, she is more in the right than I. So a man says that of a woman in Genesis. And she gets brought in, and she becomes part of the line of David, the line of Jesus, according to the New Testament. And she has a child. This is getting a little obscure, but she has a child. It's twins, and one of them starts to come out, and the midwife puts a crimson thread to figure out which one is the firstborn. But another one kind of pushes that one down and comes out. And they name that baby, who is forced itself into the royal, to be the firstborn, they say, what a breach you have made for yourself. You will be named Perez. And of course, that story is noting that Tamar has made a breach for herself. She's pushed on through. And she is righteous, according to the scripture. And Judah wasn't. But Judah has a little more of a chance of being righteous because he admitted his wrongdoing. Anyway, why do I bring this up? This is the tangent to end on tangents. I bring it up because you said, I hope you met your wife after you had evolved a little bit. And I want to confess that until I met her, I was not prone to ever defer to a woman my age. I admit it. I'm sorry. It was wrong. But she schooled me by making me rethink my relationships with people I knew then. I found deep admiration for her welling up inside me in a way that it had not before, kind of thing. So yeah, I did not intend. I have all this stuff. We have a poem. But these questions keep coming. But again, it is all of a piece of how are we going to talk religion. And I'm going to give you the microphone so that it's caught by the camera. No problem.
Can we, as Christians, make an idol of Jesus?
Okay, I'm going to take this microphone. I'm going to note again that we have a wide variety of traditions in this class. So I want to go easy on the we, while nevertheless speaking to that question. I think the extent to which one, say one wants to be a follower of Jesus, and there are followers of Jesus outside of the Christian tradition, I want to say. I think I want to say, and we can have some pushback on this, that I know many a Jew, many a Muslim, many a Buddhist, maybe even many an atheist, who take more seriously the teachings of Jesus than a lot of people who are very quick to self-identify as Christian. Does that make sense? So, of course, with the word Christian, I think this came up before when people say, sounds like you're a Christian. I want to say, okay, tell me what you mean by that, and we'll figure out whether or not I'm comfortable with that adjective being applied to me. Because it could be that we have very different definitions as to what a Christian is. An idol of Jesus. Of course, Jesus' whole gospel, the good news that Jesus came to preach, in the first few chapters of Luke, he quotes Isaiah, I've come to declare good news for the poor. And Jesus' good news, of course, isn't, I've come here to die for you so that you'll be forgiven for your sins. I mean, that is a doctrine, but that isn't the gospel, the good news, the evangel that Jesus brought. Jesus' good news is, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. So Jesus, as a prophet, his word, his gospel, is the coming kingdom. How shall we pray? Jesus' followers ask. Pray to ask me into your heart as personal Savior. No, he didn't actually. That was not the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. The prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray is, Our Father who art in heaven. And the gist of it, your kingdom come. So often I think people do make of Jesus a holy figure, in a manner of speaking, that they put on so high a pedestal that they never, is it, I don't know if high a pedestal is even the way to put it. They put Jesus in a place of supposed holiness that makes it possible for them to ignore everything Jesus actually said. Does that make sense? So there is a way of talking about Jesus as, you know, it's all about Jesus. All about, okay. Oh gosh, I so hesitate to bring this up, but I think it could be helpful. I think it could be helpful. So, and let me note that I have voted Republican and Democrat and Green in my lifetime, if that's helpful. Okay, so there was a moment, and this is religion. This is religion, but there was a moment in the Republican primaries in which Forbes, McCain, then Governor George W. Bush, do I have this right? They're all up there. They want to run for the office in 2000. You've got McCain, Forbes, Alan Keyes, whole bunch of folks. These names, Alan Keyes, y'all remember Alan Keyes by any chance? Okay, Alan Keyes, McCain, Forbes, Bush, and others. And they are asked by the moderator, name your favorite political figure, mentor kind of thing. I think that Forbes said John Locke. I think that John McCain said Teddy Roosevelt. And they made it over to George W. Bush and said, that's easy, Christ. And I saw Alan Keyes look like, oh, shoot. I saw the same look on John McCain's face, right? So the moderator then said, that's a very interesting response. I think our audience would like to know what you mean by that. And he said, changed my life. To which the moderator then said, could you be more specific? And he said, anyone I have to explain it to isn't going to understand. Okay. So I believe, let's not go nuts about it. I think that's when he sealed the deal by making an appeal to a very, very general understanding of Jesus of Nazareth. Now, it's legit insofar as a lot of his own addictions, a lot of his own dysfunctional behavior, getting out of that, his experience with Christ as he understands Christ was a part of that. Fantastic. Please don't think that I'm being derisive toward any of it. But of course, if I had been the moderator, I would have wanted to say, you know, as a Presbyterian, as a student of the Bible, as an aspiring follower of Jesus of Nazareth, that is a very interesting response. Could you tell me specifically how the teachings of Jesus are going to impact your foreign policy, your understanding of the death penalty, your welcoming of immigrants? I mean, just go on and on. It's weird to say it. We don't like it. But how will the politics of Jesus affect your politics? How will Jesus' vision of true neighborliness and true righteousness affect your vision of true neighborliness and truth? And let me just say real quick, too, there was a thing called compassionate conservatism at work around that time, and I was all about that, all about that. But Christ, as secret code, we all know what we're talking about here, and we all know that when we say Christ, it doesn't have anything to do with that. Jesus' teachings on what you do with your possessions, for instance. So there is a move, and when that move happens, I think, and please don't project on me an agenda or a particular politics or a contempt for any political party, but I think that void of content, Christ, no red letter words, Christ. You know what I mean by red letter words? A Christ that censors Jesus and the prophets might not be full-bodied Christ. Yes?
This class is very, very refreshing. I was like a lot of people in the South, raised in the Southern Baptist Church, married into the Presbyterian Church, and yet as I've gotten older, I find myself continuing to search my issues of religion evolving. And I don't know about the rest of you, but a lot of what I was taught in church, you never question. You know, I hesitate to use the word dogmatic, but and you never scratch beneath the surface to find out more about the truth of the historical Jesus. You know, exactly what do we know about Jesus and his life, and at what point do we get into the issues of his teachings and what you believe about divinity, etc. And in that search, I read a book recently, which I would be interested in your commentary, called Zealot, which was on the New York Times bestseller list.
Raise the Aslan?
Yes. Yeah. And I found it very informative. And you reach a point where you're talking about the historical Jesus, and then you have this moment where we have the return after 3 days, and we all know the stories and so on. But I'm just curious, he, I think, projects the image of Jesus as a political figure, which most of us would not identify with. And that Jesus, and then also I found enlightening the idea that the original Jewish Christians in Jerusalem, led by James the Just, his brother, and then we have Paul, who is out in the hinterlands teaching to the Greek-speaking Jews who had been dispersed from, by the Romans.
Yes.
And so now we have the beginning of this evolution from Jewish-based Christianity to the Christianity that we know. So would you care to comment on the book and what it says and so on?
Yes, I have not read the book, but I think I've read a lot of the books that he refers to in that particular book. Reza Aslan is lifting up Jesus as a Jewish peasant artisan revolutionary. You have one more thing?
Well, I would say this also. It's interesting that he went from Islam to Christianity and back to Islam again.
Yes, so Reza Aslan was a product, I think I have this right, of InterVarsity Christian college ministry. So he came, brought up a Muslim, became what we think of as an evangelical Christian via InterVarsity, involved with InterVarsity. And I haven't read the book, but I think he might have found that which passed for Christianity in his experience with particular that which passed for churches to be unworthy of a life of discipleship under Jesus. And I think he would say that he is still a follower of Jesus as a prophet within the Islamic tradition, if that makes sense. So kind of back to this idea of what does it mean to follow Jesus? I think he's completely right, and I'll recommend a book as well. Maybe somebody's read it. Anything by N.T. Wright or Marcus Borg will be really, really helpful on this early Christianity question. What was this community? What were its claims? Maybe one way of approaching it, if what Jesus brought to his community was deliverance from drug addiction, if what Jesus brought to his community was a merely personal spirituality to be had by anyone, anywhere, without challenging their behavior, their relationship with their neighbors, their relationship with the poor, their relationship with people who don't have the right citizenship. If all Jesus brought was kind of an inner, Jesus helped me get it together from me and mine, I think we could say that Jesus would have lived a long, natural life. That execution, being arrested, would not be part of his thing. So as a Jewish revolutionary movement that eventually came to include Gentiles, an inescapably social movement, those are the things that I am willing to call Christianity. The stuff that is more cultural trappings, Christianity as that which plays a chaplaincy role or a spiritual advisor role to the status quo, I call Christendom. So I make a distinction between Christianity, which would be lived thoughtfulness that seeks first God's reign, God's kingdom, God's economy. There's that. That is the tradition I think of as Christianity. And then there's this other thing. Oh gosh, I'm getting all mean about it. But where there is no witness, where there is no good news for the poor, where there is no welcoming, vulnerable, disenfranchised people, I tend to say there is no righteous witness. There is no actual Christianity being practiced there, if that makes sense. Does that?
I guess I felt like I kind of muddied the water.
No, but it is. It's helpful because it's a great book that if we're into the Bible, if we're into the Gospels, if we're interested in these things, we're going to want to know the history of the tradition. And and my study on the history doesn't make me less interested in being a practicing Christian. It makes me want to be a practicing Christian more. So reading up on the footnotes, reading up on the history, looking, oh goodness, it was recently observed, I read a little article online, that Judaism and Christianity are both refugee religions. There is no Bible without refugees. Does that make sense? That they are both, they're composed, lived out, practiced by refugee movements, which are so hospitable that they come to include non-refugees, that they come to include everyone in a way. And I think Aslan's really helpful in helping us see that. Anybody got a word on this? I hope I haven't wandered too far afield. How are we doing on time?
15.
Okay. Well, I'm completely great with another question, but I'm also great with having a look at this poem. Okay, so I think this poem, amazingly, speaks to some of the possible misunderstandings that happen between people when that elephant in the room, religion, rears its head. Okay, so here comes the poem. Actually, if I can borrow it now, that would be great. I'm going to read it out loud. I hope everybody had a chance to look at it. I'll read it out loud once, and then maybe we'll hone in on particular lines that move us in some way. A ritual to read to each other. If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, a pattern that others made may prevail in the world, and following the wrong God home, we may miss our star. For there is many a small betrayal in the mind, a shrug that lets the fragile sequence break, sending with shouts the horrible errors of childhood storming out to play through the broken dike. And as elephants parade, holding each elephant's tail, but if one wanders, the circus won't find the park. I call it cruel, and maybe the root of all cruelty, to know what occurs but not recognize the fact. And so I appeal to a voice, to something shadowy, a remote, important region in all who talk. Though we could fool each other, we should consider, lest the parade of our mutual life get lost in the dark. For it is important that awake people be awake, or a breaking line may discourage them back to sleep. The signals we give, yes or no or maybe, should be clear. The darkness around us is deep. Anybody have a general impression or a particular line? Oh, shoot. That is my failure.
No, but it's also, I thought, maybe that's the way the poet put it.
There you go. Creative misreading.
Yeah, because it says, you know, the tale is our culture, our story.
Culture, story, mutual parade, tale.
T-A-I-L is our touching each other.
Yep.
And then down here it says, and breaking line may discourage them.
Breaking line, telling a tale.
Yeah. So, anyway.
No, that's fantastic. Thank you. I mean, that was a complete error on my part, but let's view it as mistakes. Our mistakes are sometimes our hidden intentions. So let that be kind of a James Joyce pun kind of thing. In every tale a telling. So there's a telling in there going on. Thank you for that. And you signal, I mean, so much. Culture, story, are you following me? Verse, still listening? Did what I say make sense to you? No. Okay, I'm going to try again. So what you're saying is, no, that's not what I'm saying. Yes, it is. I don't know that we can go any further if you're just going to keep telling me that I only meant what you thought I meant. Are you open to the idea that I didn't mean what you say must have been what I meant? Can I try to mean again? Do you mind? Will you let me? And suddenly it's like an exorcism or a sit-in or a kind of putting a flower in a rifle or something. Yes, so there it is. Somebody else? A word? A ritual to read to each other. The signals we give should be clear. The darkness around us is deep.
This fourth line in the first verse.
Okay, so he's saying the fourth line in the first verse. I'm going to hand you the microphone.
And following the wrong God home, we may miss our star.
Yes.
Tell me more.
Okay, well, I invite anything from anybody on that, but following the wrong God home... I think it's appropriate whenever we say the word God, and in some traditions, you're just not supposed to say the word God at all, or you put a little G and a dash in there. But whenever you say the word God, you're probably going to want to take a breath and go ahead and presume that you do not know what you're talking about. I mean, you're going to risk it. You're going to risk saying it, but you don't want to use God's name in vain. You don't want to use love's name in vain. And we are apt to fall into false worship in the old time. Idolatry, all that kind of thing. Or wicked worship that we mistake for true worship. So following the wrong God home, we may miss what we needed in order for everybody to be okay and live and thrive and that kind of thing. Did you have more on that one?
It's a small g.
It is a small g. There are many small g's. I once heard a rabbi say, I am an atheist when it comes to so many gods. And that was just such a helpful thing, because people throw the word around and it's generally presumed, you know, God kind of thing. I remember when this, I'll be careful with this again, but when John Kerry lost, he said, I'll end with a prayer. God bless America. And I thought, ooh, I'd never thought of that as a prayer. I thought of it as a boast, a kind of God blesses America. But God, comma, bless America. That was kind of nice. So anyway, gods, many gods, a lot of God talk, many a false witness to God, many an appeal to God that is actually just an appeal to rage, hatred even. So following the wrong God home, we're looking, we're trying to figure it out, but we very often get it wrong. We call God that which is not God. Okay, so I'm going to go over to you, and then I'm going to go to you.
Do I need to push a button?
No, it's ready to go.
Okay. I was thinking as an example to his question, and following the wrong God home, we may miss our star. You as an example, when
yes.
You're listening to following
yes. Yes, I get out of bed in the morning looking for a good story that's going to help me feel good about whatever it is that I'm going to do in my day. And I often am going to find an allegedly trusted source, which it turns out is a false source. Fake news. I like to say poetry is news that isn't fake. Yes?
I don't know how to put this without embarrassing you, but you will definitely be in my Parthenon of Elders.
Oh, thank you, thank you.
In the course of reading your book, and I highly recommend that you all purchase this book and read it. It's definitely a paradigm shift for me in terms of viewing religion.
Mm-hmm.
The reason why I took this class, I was telling a friend of mine earlier, was because of the title of the class,
mm-hmm.
because religions I am not.
Yes.
Then to discover from your perspective, this new paradigm for me, that religion is something we engage in on a daily basis.
Yes.
You know, and that makes it just wonderfully holistic all the way around.
Oh, well, thank you.
I would love to have had you as my parent. Or my husband.
Oh, well, thank you.
My brother.
Yes, yes.
You're a wonderful teacher.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'm going to keep trying. And thank you. Thank you. And that, yeah, and I love that you, the title, which is a bit of a provocation, that you never, even though you don't think of yourself as religious, that you are willing to, okay, well, the way he's doing it, it's common. And so, according to my argument, which again, is kind of a rare, not at all popular argument at this point in American history, is that you're never not worshiping in one way or another. We're all devoted in one way or another to something or other all the time. And we talked a couple weeks back, we talked as we were walking through the parking lot, and I'm really glad that it's going well for you. Okay. So, well, she's just saying we have 5 minutes left, so we do have time.
In looking at the poem and the first verse, it's like two people in a small community talking to each other and following certain conventions.
Yes.
And never really getting to what's going on in their lives.
Yes.
And consequently never finding that either of them may have knowledge or help to help them solve whatever their concerns are.
Yes.
And I think the whole thing sort of speaks to that. If we never get beyond the surface in our conventions,
yes,
then we can't help each other.
That's right. And he's a Quaker, William Stafford. So this thing of we're going to sit and we're going to be quiet and maybe somebody's going to have a word, and everybody is capable of having a word, I mean, that's remains a revolutionary thing that we can forget exists in an age of high-tech haste in which people are talking very quickly and cutting each other off. And whoever successfully cuts off the other person wins. So we're in the thick of this. But there's this other way that millions of people around the world are undertaking. And it is indeed, I mean, that first, if we're not careful, a pattern that others made is going to prevail here. It's not our pattern. It isn't for us. It's this other thing that doesn't have anything to do with us that nevertheless dictates the way we look at each other and think of each other. So kind of back to labels. If all I think of is so-and-so is this, you know they are. Okay, you have just cut that person down to size to a degree, but you have not done justice to the living mystery that they are. So this is like a prayer, like an exorcism. It's like a kind of, so many of the words from this poem I kind of carry around with me when I'm trying to think through a conflict, think through how to respond to somebody. I think it could be that we're, maybe one more word, question, comment on the poem? Yes.
One thing that I did say in my email is not only to have an open mind, but to have an inquiring mind.
Yes. Inquiring minds want to know. To have, to want to know when you're wrong. Okay, so that's quite the pilgrimage. To wake up presuming that you are possessed of perhaps some mistaken ideas about other people. And your job for the day is to figure out what's true rather than what you want to be true. That would make you us philosophers. Maybe, I'll know this is a quirk, I don't see many people who feel it this way, I'm not willing to affix the adjective Christian to people who aren't committed to that process in some way. And by that I don't mean they're not Christians so they're not loved of God. No, everybody's loved of God, my goodness. All God's children. But many of us are estranged from right relationship and honesty and all that kind of stuff. Okay, so I think we will probably begin with the poem next time because I know that there's more to be said about this poem and we'll keep on going with other things. And I'll mention, I do have 5 of those. Nobody has to buy one. Please never feel that pressure. But if you wanted one today, I could give you one for a check or cash. So thank you all very much. Thank you.